60 years ago, long before the climate change scares, the world was told that the Great Barrier Reef was being decimated by coral-eating starfish and only had a decade or so to live. So why didn't it die? Crown-of-thorns starfish eat coral, and in the case of the Great Barrier Reef, they eat a lot of coral. So for every one of the 3,000 reefs of the 2,000 kilometre long Great Barrier Reef, a lot of that coral will be eaten over a period of a decade or two. Now, it's often thought that crown-of-thorns starfish are a feral animal that's been introduced from overseas, and in fact Australia's had an awful record with introduced species like cats, rabbits and cane toads, which have done a lot of damage to the Australian fauna and flora. But crown-of-thorns starfish aren't like that. They're as native to Australia as wombats and kangaroos. They are, however, found in other parts of the world. You can see here the areas of coral that have been eaten by the crown-of-thorns starfish. Remember that it's only the surface of the coral that is actually alive. That's where the polyp is. As the crown-of-thorns starfish move across the surface, they digest the living part, leaving the white calcium carbonate skeleton of the coral. So the big question is, are these plagues natural, or is there something that people have done to cause the explosion in numbers? And it's interesting to look back at the research in the early days of the Great Barrier Reef, remembering that we knew very little about the reef before the 1960s, because there were almost no scientists studying it before then. So this article is from the old Walkabout magazine, and it's about Robert Endine, one of the pioneers of research on the reef and discoverer of the crown-of-thorns starfish plagues. And this is what he said. Before the 1960s, the crown-of-thorns starfish had been a rare animal. In 1960, it was still such a novelty that when a single specimen appeared on the reef outside Cairns, naturalists made special trips to observe it. Why then did it emerge from obscurity in 1963 to become a plague on the Great Barrier Reef? Well, it's a good question, and there are two possibilities. The first is that humans started to do something around the early 60s. The second thing is that, well, maybe nobody was looking before then. These plagues, without doubt, these plagues were a big issue in the late 60s and 70s. And I remember growing up in Innisfail, which is adjacent to the reef. All my school friends were worrying about what was going to happen to the reef. And we were told that the crown-of-thorns starfish plagues was moving south, and soon the whole reef would have been completely eaten and gone. It was actually very scary. Well, 50 years on, things don't look so bad. And we really need to look at the work of the marine geologists, who I will mention a lot in this series, because they take a much longer perspective on the Great Barrier Reef. So Bob Henderson here and various of his students like Peter Walbrand essentially looked at the history of the crown-of-thorns starfish on the reef. When a crown-of-thorns starfish dies, the skeletal remains are preserved on the reef and they get slowly buried as the dead coral builds up. Remembering that a coral reef is just a high pile of rubble, 50 to 100 metres high, and it grows by about 1 metre every 1,000 years. So if you drill a hole in a reef, you can actually go down and essentially look back in time at what animals were living there then. And that's what Bob Henderson did in the early 90s. And they demonstrated that crown-of-thorns starfish outbreaks have actually been around for millennia. They didn't appear in the 1960s, as Robert Endine had feared. They'd been around for a very long time indeed. But Robert Endine was certainly right about one thing. The crown-of-thorns starfish essentially do eat more or less the whole of the reef eventually, but it completely recovers. So this data is from the Australian Institute of Marine Science, from their long-term monitoring surveys, which have been going on for about 35 years. And this was started because of fears that the crown-of-thorns starfish were getting out of control. I was actually working at Ames when this work started, and I remember well the frenetic activity that was associated with it. And you can see here that in the early 80s, there was a big plague out on the reef, and then it waned, and then it came back in the early 2000s, and then there's been a bit of a resurgence in the last few years, but the coral always recovers. And so now we've got record amounts of coral on the Great Barrier Reef, though clearly the amount of coral goes up and down with time. Nevertheless, it would still be nice to know what causes these crown-of-thorns starfish plagues. Robert Endine and others in those early days surmised that the cause was that there wasn't enough triton shells, which is a predator of the crown-of-thorns starfish. Tritons had been reduced in number by overfishing. But in recent years, the blame has shifted squarely against farmers, and the hypothesis now goes that nutrients from the fertiliser from farms is causing the crown-of-thorns starfish outbreaks. The hypothesis says that the nutrients cause phytoplankton blooms. Phytoplankton are small floating plants. These are eaten by the crown-of-thorns starfish larvae, and then a plague forms due to the extra nutrients. Now, this link between nutrients, farmers, and crown-of-thorns starfish seems like a reasonable hypothesis, but when it is subjected to the facts, it pretty well falls over. The first thing is that it's fairly well accepted that most of the main plagues start somewhere around Lizard Island and then move south. But the biggest source of nutrients is the Burdekin River. Now, if it was the nutrients affecting the plagues, then we should see the outbreaks much closer to the Burdekin River, not 600 kilometres away from the source up at Lizard Island. The other problem is we've got to remember there's been a persistent outbreak of crown-of-thorns starfish in the Swains Reef. Now, the Swains are the furthest away from the coast and completely unaffected by agriculture. The other problem is that the starfish plagues occur in places where there is no agriculture, like on the west coast of Australia and in Pacific Islands where there is no agriculture at all. So there's a lot of doubt about this hypothesis that agriculture is causing the plagues. Maybe the plagues are just entirely natural. In 2017, a group of crown-of-thorns starfish specialists wrote a review paper summarising the last 30 years of research on the starfish, and they concluded on the question of whether humans have been influencing the plagues, they concluded that that was unresolved. And they stated that the farming hypothesis was also unresolved. And they certainly said that we actually need to do a lot more research before we actually even understand what causes the starfish plagues at all. But despite this, the Queensland government recently introduced legislation essentially blaming farmers for the plagues and drastically curtailing their use of fertilisers. So how did this happen? How is it that the group of experts are saying that the crown-of-thorns starfish may be entirely natural, but there's government legislation against the farmers? Well, one of the problems is if you look at the very influential reports done by the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park Authority, it doesn't mention any of the doubts about the links between farmers and the crown-of-thorns starfish. It doesn't mention the work of Bob Henderson that demonstrated that these plagues have been around for millennia. And so what we're seeing here is an example of where the scientific institutions are, in part, failing us. Now, this is not good enough. We need to be able to rely on our scientific institutions to reflect the data that we've got. And that demonstrates that the link between agriculture and the starfish is very tenuous, that the plagues come and go in places where there's no agriculture, and also that the geological evidence indicates that they've been around for millennia. But irrespective of whether the legislation is misplaced, the last 30 years of research on crown-of-thorns starfish certainly seems to indicate that those early concerns are now not quite so worrying. So everything actually seems quite encouraging.